السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. رحب بحضراتكم ورحب بالدكتورة فرح، أستاذ مساعد في الجامعة الألمانية في الأردن، حاصل على الماجستير في التصميم الموفر للطاقة، ودكتوراه في الرواح الحرارية والتحكم في بيئة المكاتب الداخلية، وإن شاء الله محاضرة ممتعة في مجال الاستدامة، وجزاكم الله كل خير. الله يكرمك يا دكتور.
شكرا كثير، يعطيكم العافية. Thank you very much actually for the organization group for inviting me. And I would like to thank the audience for attending or their interest in attending this lecture. So I will talk about sustainability, thermal comfort and personal control. Let's start within the sustainability. So I think you are familiar within the this term sustainability. It's a very becoming very important topic for construction research and also in all the other sections, not also in the construction level. It's a multidimensional topic involving social, economic, and environmental aspects. So the sustainable construction, which is related to our sector, related to the architecture, civil engineering, and so on, it refers to the application of principles of sustainable development in the construction industry. One of the most common definitions of sustainable development is introduced by the World Commission on Environment and Development. So, and it's that the humanity has the ability to make development sustainable to ensure that it meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. This is the most common definition of sustainability on the different sectors. But when we are talking about sustainable construction, one of the detailed definition of it related to Rainsford, it's as the set of processes by which a competitive industry delivers built assessed buildings, structures, supporting infrastructure, and their immediate surroundings, which enhance the quality of life and offer customer satisfaction. The customer satisfaction is really very important as it's a key of a successful design. Sustainability must actually offer flexibility and the potential to cater for user changes in the future, because all the sustainable strategies actually they are planned for long term, over a period of 10 years, 30 years, and it's not on the short term. So it should be flexible, and also to provide and support the natural and social environments and maximize the efficient use of resources. Of course, here we are talking about the green energy sources such as the solar and the wind. So the main aspect or main dimensions, they are related to economic, social, and environment. When we are talking about social, it's the improving the quality of human life, seeking fair distribution of the benefits of construction. Economic, the main thing actually is to maintain high and stable levels of economic growth and support the local economy. And talking about the environmental, it's conserve the energy, the water, the land, the materials, and consider the renewable, green, and clean energy sources. So in order to achieve all these goals, several codes, green building systems, locally and regionally, internationally, were developed. In Jordan, we have codes related to energy efficiency, such as the energy efficiency building code, solar energy code, thermal insulation, and the green building guideline. And LEED, it's very common, it's internationally common and all over, for and it stands for the leadership in energy and environmental design. It's internationally recognized green buildings or a green building certification system. I would like just to talk about the LEED a little bit, as it includes these categories. In order to have a LEED certificate, you have to earn points in each category, and at the end you will get one of these four levels of leads. So it concentrates actually on the sustainable sites, how to choose the site from the beginning, the location between the site and the local public transportation, and also how creative the design is, the use of water efficiency and the recycling of the water, using of green and clean energy sources such as the sun and the wind, and using of healthy materials in the indoor environment, and also the recycling of the materials. Talking about the indoor environment quality, here we are addressing the thermal comforts, which I will introduce later on. And a very important thing related to the categories, also related to the lead, is raising awareness and education. It's not just applying the requirements, but they are responsible to encourage others to go in this direction and to show how they save the energy in order that the people, they will go for these strategies, and also allow the researchers to conduct field surveys, researches in the buildings after the construction in order to learn and from the construction process and evaluate if it works well or not. So the lead has actually four levels, which is the certified silver and gold and platinum, which is the highest one, earning 80 plus points. I would like to have some examples, case studies here in Jordan for LEED certified buildings. The first actually building to be awarded the gold LEED, and it's not in Jordan, but in the Eastern Mediterranean region, is the WHO, the World Health Organization. It occupies an area of around 2,500 square meters, which was designed by Ingecon, and the total floor area is around 500 square meters. This building was so they had the LEED in 2011, and they improved the energy efficiency by around 23%, and saving the water by 60%. And it's worth mentioning actually that now they reached around 80% saving for the energy efficiency, because they are using more solar panels to produce electricity. Here I would like just to show you the categories related to the LEED. So as we said, that the LEED has all these categories, and there are sub dimensions or sub points in each category. This is an example of the indoor environment quality. The building earned 12 points out of 15. So they were able actually to increase the ventilation through the windows, even the doors, outdoor doors, and using low-emitting materials for painting, for the coatings and the carpets, so for the pavements. The daylighting, it's something very important, and they were able to achieve that in most of the offices. Also, they use the shading devices internally and exterior also shading devices. So in general, the working atmosphere inside the building, it's healthy and very friendly. The second building I would like to mention, also it's a LEED certified, gold LEED certified building in Jordan. It's the Middle East Insurance Company. It's the second building in Jordan after the WHO that got the LEED certification. And what I would like to mention about this building that it was really, it's not about, so they achieved very high quality of the indoor healthy environments, but also the design of it from the outside, as you can notice, that it respects all the surrounding. There's a harmony within the building heights. The heights or the facades or the heights are graduated. This is actually the architect Faris Boqa'in considered the height of the buildings on this street or this facade as most of the build of the houses. They are just maximum 3 or 4 floors height, while on the other side of the streets there are some tall buildings. So the building respects the surrounding, there's a harmony with it, even the using of materials as shading devices, that's mesh and the stone, it's the local material to build in Jordan. So it's about the design. They were able to achieve very high points related to this category, innovation and design, in addition to the other categories. Also, they have very high performance in human and environmental health, sustainable site development. They are saving water and using energy efficient materials. 20% of the materials were manufactured regionally, mainly in Jordan and Palestine. So they used also the grey water reuse and rainwater harvesting, which allowed them to reduce the landscape or the water used in the landscape by 50% and having a reduction of 40% in the indoor water use. Also, 50% reduction in wastewater generation, and they are so making recycling for the water, using it in the irrigation and toilet flushing for cleaning and so on. And here is, you can see the interior of the offices. They are well ventilated. All the windows, they are operable. They can open it and close it upon their needs. Also, they have shading devices internally and externally. One of the examples of the building's Izzat Marji headquarter building, that was they achieved the requirements related to the Jordan Green Building Guide. And as you can see in the picture, they used the solar panels in the facade for, of course, using the solar panels to produce the electricity and also the energy for the building, and as shading devices. As well as the vertical shading devices you can see on the west facades, green roofs, using of green walls to decrease the heating and cooling demands of the building. So they integrated a lot of sustainable solutions. I would like just to go briefly through some of the design strategies that we have to consider when we are designing energy efficient buildings. The first thing is about how choose your site carefully. If you are building a new building, it's very important to be close to the commercial, religious, and schools, bakeries, banks. So in order to reduce the CO2 emission for the transportation, stay close to the public transportation, reduce the building footprints. In Jordan, according to the regulation, that's 25% of the total site area is allowed to be built in the urban areas, and 40% of the total site area in the suburbans. This is will allow us to drop the surrounding temperature, reduce urban heat island effects, and reduce surface water runoff, in addition to enjoy the nature, as to have greenery, as we are in Amman, especially we lack the open spaces and the greenery or parks and so on. So it's really important to have such developments in order to have healthier environments. In addition to the rainwater harvesting, it's one of the most, one of the very important strategies, especially in our region, because we don't have a lot of rainfall and the deserts also. So it's our responsibility to collect that water for during the rainwater harvesting or through the rainwater harvesting and use it later on for irrigation, cleaning and flushing the toilets. Using materials, using the open grid pavements, such as the materials that allows water infiltrate through the surface and into the soil. This is what reduce the surface water runoff and reduce the flooding. We faced in Amman some flooding during the last year, so this infrastructure choosing of materials will help to reduce such effects. Also, talking about other design strategies is understanding the climate. Understanding the climate is actually the key, the most important and initial step to consider when you are designing energy efficient buildings. It differs. You have to understand all the details related to the site. It differs between different areas within the same country and, of course, from country to another. So this example is related also to Amman. It's very important to prevent the sunlight entering the building in the summer because it reduces the it reduces the cooling loads, and we can do that actually by having the right shading devices, as the sun angle in Jordan, the sun is very high in the sky and the angle it reaches 82 degrees. So in summer, this angle should be considered when designing the width of the horizontal shading device. And the angle in winter, it's around 35 degree. So it allows the solar energy to enter the house. So these angles, they are very important to consider when designing the shading devices. For the south facade, it's very easy actually to control the solar axis, as the angles, they are perpendicular and very easy. We can easy to block it, but in the east and west facades, the solar axis or the sun, it's very intense and more difficult to control. Because of that, we have to use a vertical shading devices, or actually in combination between vertical and horizontal. To control the solar axis, we can benefit from the trees. Trees can help in shading our building. So using the deciduous trees can block up to 85% of the sun's radiation in summer. In winter, when the leaves drop, they allow up to 70% of sun's energy to pass. So as shown in this in these two graphs. And it's very cheap and easy to apply, just to have the correct deciduous trees. And also the green roofs. So the green roof is a system that uses vegetation as roof cover. The implementation actually of the green roof, 17% of the heating and cooling energy demands can be reduced. And it's a very good percentage. Also the U value, as most of the buildings in Jordan, they are not well insulated. So having the higher U value it means that it's less insulation and more heat loss. We have to consider reaching lower U values, so for more insulation in order to have less heat loss. Nowadays, we are building such as the graph on the right, left side, but it's very important to reach low number of U value, and we can reach easily 0.15 watts per meter square Kelvin by having 5 to 10% insulation material, and this is will reduce the cooling and heating loads for the end demand energy. These were some of the design strategies we have to consider when designing energy efficient buildings, and now I would like to go or to switch to the thermal comfort. So thermal comfort is a very important topic in the research in order to achieve a comfortable indoor environment. The internationally accepted definition related to the ASHRAE, it's the American Association for Heating, Refrigerating and Air Conditioning. The definition is the condition of mind which expresses satisfaction with the thermal environments, but this definition's a definition with the years, or has been subjective actually, or subject to several criticisms, because the condition of mind, it's not that clear, which could be the consequence of either a process of perception or a state of knowledge or a common feeling or attitude based on psychological point of view. So we can actually define the thermal comfort it was suggested by me to define the thermal comfort as it is influenced by individual differences which are affected by physical, physiological, psychological, cultural and social factors among others. As a result, there is no absolute value of thermal comfort, but it will be relative to comfort zone within the surrounding thermal environments, which depends on the individual's experience and expectations, as well as the thermal climates. It's very important to mention that the range of comfortable temperatures differs between one person to another, and also differs between different climates, different countries. So, and there is no absolute, just correct number. It's a range of temperatures that we have to achieve inside the buildings in order to achieve high percentage of satisfaction for all the users. So why the thermal comfort is important? Actually, it delivers satisfactory conditions for occupants, and this is the aim of any design, to deliver the satisfaction for the users, because if the users, they are not satisfied, it means that it's not a good or successful design. It allows us to control the energy consumption and reduce the heating and cooling demands. It's propose and set standards for such thermal circumstances. The advantages of it also increasing the opportunity of personal control. I will talk about personal control at the end, and improving the internal air quality, achieving energy savings, and reducing the CO2 production, which is a responsibility for all of us nowadays, enhancing the efficiency of building occupants, and improving changing the standards to enrich the indoor thermal comfortability. The thermal comfort parameters, we can divide them into two main categories, which are the environmental variables and the personal parameters. The environmental variables are air temperature, radiant temperature, air velocity, and humidity. And we can measure them. And the other two personal parameters, they are the clothing insulation and miserable grids. Usually we are collecting this data through questionnaires and or even just observation in the field. In the field when we are conducting the different research inside the buildings, surveys. These are the instruments we are using in the research of thermal comfort to measure the air temperature, humidity, the air velocity, and the radiant temperature. They differ between the different brands and also the accuracy of them. But it's important to use them in order to understand the indoor environments and then relate that to the results of the questionnaire, because you are asking the persons if they are satisfied, not satisfied, feeling comfortable or not. So after measuring the indoor temperature, you can know that when they answered comfortable, that was in the range of, for example, 20 to 28 degrees, and they had very discomfort when the temperature was very low or very high. And these ranges of temperatures, they differ actually from one country to another. It depends on the experience, on the expectations of the users. The personal parameters, they are related to the metabolic rate and the clothing. Metabolic rate, it's when the person is sleeping, it's around 1.2 to 0.8. During the jogging, it's 8, and relaxing, it's 1 minute, because we are producing energy actually when we are having heavy activities. And this is also influence our comfort or discomfort inside the building. The other thing related to the clothing. So we have to collect also these data, because at the end we have to consider all these dimensions and enter them into equations, mathematical and physical one, in order to reach the range of comfortable temperature. This is one of the examples of the models, but I will skip it now because it differs actually between one country to another and within the same country. From one season to another season, we have to set ranges of comfort temperature according to the different seasons, as these factors, they are changeable, and you can't have so you will feel, for example, comfort in different range between winter and summer, because of all the conditions, they are different. About personal control. One, personal control, it's a very new topic in research. It's it's relating to involve the users actually to set their own need, their own comfort zones, because it differs from one person to another. One of the most famous and successful definition of personal control is for Helvig, which is having the opportunity to adjust occupants' indoor environment according to their needs and preferences in the case of discomfort. When occupants have the knowledge of their ability to change the surrounding indoor environment according to their previous experience, they will be more confident in the potential to become comfortable in their indoor spaces if discomfort should occur. So the personal control, it has three parts, or divided into three categories: the available control, and exercise, and perceived. So available control, it's relates or refer to the availability of the control options. When we are talking about control percentages or control options, example of that is the window, when you can operable window, if the window you can open it or close it in order to change the temperature, the indoor environment conditions. Also the interior and exterior doors, because you can change the ventilation through these adaptive opportunities. Blinds, of course, to block the solar access, and personal fans, personal heaters, thermostats when you are adjusting the thermostat for the ACs. So and choosing a specific set point temperature. So you are more. These are the available control options. Exercise control. It refers to the frequency, to the relative frequency with which the building users engage in indoor environmental adaptive behaviors. So how many times did you open the window, close it, or open the doors, indoor and outdoor doors in order to change the interior environment and to achieve, of course, the comfort, because usually you will have this exercise control when you feel discomfort. And the perceived control is psychological aspects of the personal control, because it refers to the degree to which building users believe they can cause desired changes in the indoor environment. I would relate to one of the studies conducted in Jordan. So as I said in that, when we are talking about thermal comfort and personal control, we have to conduct and gather information and data through the different seasons, from spring, summer, autumn, and winter, because in Jordan we have these four seasons. In some countries it's enough to have just data in winter and summer, because they don't have spring and autumn, or the length of these seasons, it's very short. So usually we are doing the measurements using the instruments I showed before, and collecting the data if the users, they are comfortable or not comfortable, or the perception of the users. And also the questions related to the personal control through questionnaires, written or digital questionnaires, during taking the measurements, so we can relate the measurements to the answers of each user. And in this study, we collected around 700 questionnaires, and 119 persons were involved in three buildings. And these buildings, they are the first two, they are the LEED certified buildings in Jordan, which I introduced at the beginning. And the third one, it's naturally ventilated and passively cooled traditional building related to an architect, very famous architect in Amman, Farouk Yaghmour. The case studies were conducted in these buildings. Here I would like just to mention that the adaptive controls, they are the windows, the blinds, the thermostats, the interior doors and exterior doors, personal fans, heaters, and the thermostats. What we are addressing and in the questionnaires, it's related to the perceived availability. So the perceived availability is a subjective perception, is the subjective opinion. It's the belief of having or not having actually the control option. And the question related to that is, do you have these options in order to control the indoor climate? When we are talking about desired control, it's the wish for control options. It's to adjust the indoor environment. It's your wish to have operable windows in your workplace or in your home, or blinds or thermostats. Some persons, they prefer the natural ventilation and so the windows, and others, they are relying on the active systems. So it's about the desired control. The relationship actually between these desired control, perceived control, and the availability of the control options, they are categorized or defined in consistency and conformity of expectations. Consistency is the relation between the objective availability of the control options and the perceived availability of these control options. And the conformity, it's the relation between the perceived availability and the desired control, in order just to have clear understanding of that. So talking about the consistency between the perceived and objective availability, we can divide that into three categories: the restrictions, consistency, and false positive assumption. Restrictions means that the users, they are facing problems actually, or restrictions in using the windows, the doors, the available control opportunities. That means maybe the window is available, but they can't open it, or it's not reachable. Or several persons, they are sharing the same space, and because of that, they can't, even if it's available, they can't open it because they have to negotiate that with others before making this action. So the availability of the control option doesn't mean that you can use it. And because of that, here we have the restrictions. Consistency, if you have the control option and you can perceive availability of it. So in this case, there's a consistency between the real physical availability of the control options and your perceived of that. And the false positive assumption, actually, when the users, they are answering that they have control over that control option, but it's not available in their offices or homes. And this, it's very important case also, because it means that that control option is not important for these people, or they didn't try to use it before. Talking about the conformity, so we can also divide it into three categories, which are the negative non-conformity, conformity, and the positive non-conformity. The negative non-conformity, it's when you wish to have a control option, such as a operable window, but you don't have it in your office or in your home. So, or you wish to have the AC, but you don't have that AC to control your indoor environments. In this case, it's negative conformity, when you wish to have that control option and you have it. And positive non-conformity, when the building offers more control options more than desired. So the users, they don't prefer to have heaters and fans, thermostats, but the building has all these options. When we are talking about also exercise control, it's very important that it's not just the physical availability of them, but the psychological aspects plays a very important role, because sometimes you want to make an action, but you can't do it because you have, especially if you are sharing the same space with other persons, so you have to ask them if you want to open that control option, close it, or even leave it as is. So this is related to exercise control. The reasons for not exercising the available adaptive controls, even that if the users, they are dissatisfied or not feeling comfortable. Sometimes it relates to no success expected. And in this category, we are talking about previous experience. So if you tried to switch on the thermostats, and you didn't reach the comfort zone you are willing or wishing to have it along a very long time. So then within the time you will stop using that control option or the thermostat or the windows because your previous experience was very bad. No need to change. If you're feeling comfortable, usually you will not make any change or to adjust, switch on, switch off the control options. That's important for some person. They can work or sit in all environments, so it doesn't matter if it's they are feeling discomfort, but they will not make any action. So it's a personal psychological aspect. Usually that most of the people, if they didn't make an action because they 73% of them, they are feeling comfortable. The second category related to no success expected if they had a bad experience, so they will stop using that control option, and not important, it's the least important or reason for not exercising any available control. At the end, I would like to show you an example of one of the buildings or the running projects nowadays in Jordan. It's a family center in Marka. It will be renovated. It's a small building, has a small library, computer labs, and a garden for the children, for the community, to help the community actually. And it's a cooperation between Germany and Jordan. It's a team from Amman and Dresden. The team from Amman involves persons from the Amman, Greater Amman Municipality, and the German Jordan University. My colleague Tala is working also on this project. So this is the designed, so maybe just to remember, this is the real or the current situation, and this is the aim or the design after finishing the construction. So the traditional architecture concepts are combined within the modern elements. The old and the new buildings will be renovated and built in such a way that they are documenting new energy standards for Jordan. And the main task and the main thing of that is to achieve a thermal comfort, a very healthy, comfortable atmosphere without using air conditioning. It's just natural ventilation and without any active system, active system. So the project, the red one is the addition and the new parts, because the project is enlarging the family center. And the old one is the gray one in the gray color. This is the end effect by combining the old and the new to have more classes, to have the courtyard. Actually, the main point of this shape is to create or to have a courtyard in the middle, because the courtyard is one of the most efficient design, energy efficient solutions in order to reduce the energy consumption. And here you can see also the E1. E1 is one of the very important and traditional parts of the traditional Arabian houses. So usually it's in the north, it's shaded, it provides very comfortable atmosphere. And here you can use the concept, because to maintain good ventilation, the using of wind towers. So we have four wind towers to control the circulation, the air circulation, and the panels or the roof, they are responsible to produce the energy for the electricity. In the not only in the building, but also for the garden or the park, and also to provide shaded when people, they are using the roof. So these are the facades. They are respecting the traditional facades, using mushrabiye also to as shading devices, and that's just an example of the projects. And thank you very much for listening. So.
جزاكم الله كل خير يا دكتورة على المحاضرة القيمة. أستاذنك لو ناخد بس الأسئلة من الناس، لو حد عنده أي أسئلة.
Sure.
لو أي حد عنده أي سؤال يقدر يفتح المايك.
ما حدا عنده سؤال؟
الله يكرمك. هل في أنظمة للاستدامة موجودة في الأردن زي يعني منافسة للليد والبريم؟
We have the energy. في فعلياً energy efficiency codes. It has also يعني requirements like the leads, but with respect لل local climate. So yes, we have. بس المشكلة بال بهاي guidelines إنه هي مش إجبارية. So when you apply it, تقدر تأخذ على incentives, بس مش إجباري to إنك تحقق كل هاي requirements.
طيب لو انا قدام فرصه مثلا ان انا اعمل مبنى بالاستدامه بالافكار دي كلها، بس المالك مش عايز يدفع فلوس على موضوع الشهاده، يعني المالك مش عايز ياخد شهاده ليد، بس لو عايز احط افكار تصميميه فده ممكن؟ يعني اعمل تصميم بس هو مش ياخد شهاده.
بدون ايش؟ عفوا؟
هو عايز يعني اللي بيسال لو انا عايز اعمل تصميم للمبنى سواء معماري او كهروميكانيكال بأفكار الليد، بس أنا مش ناوي أخد شهادة ليد، فهل ده هيبقى صح ولا غلط؟
يعني usually لأنه أنت محقق هاي requirements ف it's better to have the lead. The lead it's a good certification, but على long run فأنت رح تلاحظ أنه قد في reducing of the energy use. ف it's having the certificate or not, بالنهاية you have the benefit of reducing the energy used in the building, برضو كل ال loads على cooling and heating. The certificate it's just any certified prestigious ممكن, or you can use it for advertisements, commercial things. بس achieving all these things هو فعليا رح ينعكس على satisfaction in the building بتوفير الطاقة كمان.
طيب في مهندس مدني بيسأل هل المهندس المدني ليه أي دور في موضوع الاستدامة أو موضوع الليد، ولا هو خاص بالعمارة بس؟
لا طبعا هي عبارة عن integration approach, holistic approach, يعني هو عبارة عن موضوع بضم كل يعني المهندسين المعماريين, ال civic engineers, الميكانيكال, لأن الميكانيكال كمان بيشتغلوا على الأنظمة ال cooling وال heating, كيف إنها تكون energy efficient, حتى مثلا lighting. فأكيد ال civic يعني civic engineering engineers لهم دور كثير مهم بتحقيق ال requirements.
تمام يا دكتور، جزاكم الله كل خير. لو في أي حد عنده أسئلة تاني؟ لا الحمد لله تمام، جزاكم الله كل خير يا دكتور، ألف شكر لحضرتك.
شكرا شكرا، يعطيكم العافية. Thank you. يسلم يسلم. باي باي.